John, am I right in thinking that this is your seventh opera, Jane Eyre?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah?
I've never actually counted them, but I think seven is right.
Yeah.
Yes.
You've always had a great fascination for the genre of opera.
Yes.
Perhaps you'd like to talk about it a little bit, the reasons why it fascinates you so much.
Well, I think when I came to London in 1946, I became very interested in going to the Wagner performances with Kirsten Flagstaff and Hans Hotter and some of the big stars of that time. I would go to the summer Wagner season, but I more or less ignored Italian opera at the time. I thought the Italian style was light music compared to Wagner. But then, oddly enough, when I left London in 1950 to take up a job in Hull, the university there, I all of a sudden began to take an interest in Italian opera. The only opera one could get in Hull was from either local amateur companies or touring companies, smaller touring companies like the Carl Rosa, who gave very lively performances of the standard Italian repertoire, which I found myself enjoying very much. So at the moment, I went off Wagner for a bit and was very, very interested in Verdi, particularly late Verdi. But then eventually I came back to Wagner again because I think I had to lecture about him here at the university. And I found out so much more about him than I did when I first used to hear the operas without really understanding what they were all about. But opera became ultimately the thing that I was most interested in and very urgently wanted to contribute to.
Had you had any experience of opera when you were at home still in South Africa?
Not really, no. I remember going to see Carmen, but it really didn't at the time mean very much to me.
No. And of course they have in Cape Town opera now, a world famous operatic company, so things have changed there presumably.
Yes, and they've got a very marvellous theatre as well.
Oh, right.
I remember seeing a Tristan there, not in the old days, but on a visit. And it was really quite a sort of international standard, I would have thought.
Mm. Yeah. You've always had a great love of literature as well.
Yes. Well, I think that's part of the attraction of opera, that it brings in words, brings in characters, situations, the progression of drama, and with all sorts of things that can't happen in other dramatic performances. I mean, things like ensembles and arias, and they all attracted me very much. And one of the first operas I got very involved with was Stravinsky's The Rake's Progress, which quite rapidly became one of my favourite operas. And I was amazed how he treats the whole ancient form of opera with recitative and aria ensembles. Mm-hmm. And yet in a modern style, in a personal style, and it seemed to work so brilliantly. Yeah. Part of the brilliance, of course, is the libretto by Auden. But for a long time, I loved that opera. I still do.
You talked about your interest in Wagner, the Italian composers, especially, I should imagine, Giuseppe Verdi.
Yes.
And you just talked about Igor Stravinsky. Would you point to any influences from other composers in your own works?
Yes, I think the major influence has been Britten, of course, who's a great opera composer, I think. And I remember My first Britain opera was The Rape of Lucretia, which I heard in 1947 in Lucerne. The English opera group were doing a tour of Europe. And I went along to see it and was really knocked over by it.
Mm-hmm. When I'm thinking about Jane Eyre, I sometimes think about Britain's Turn of the Screw as well. Is that because it's contemporaneous in its...
I suppose it has elements of the Turn of the Screw, but it's not like the Turn of the Screw, a ghost story. I think it is really just a realistic but romantic novel. And it seemed to me to have some operatic potential in it.
What was it actually that attracted you to Jane Eyre?
I think because it's a great love story, and I thought one should be able still to write about love in one's work. After all, it's perhaps the basic emotion for most people, everybody. And it seemed to me a very great love story.
Mm. The ending of the opera is magical. But is there a question at the end as well?
Oddly enough, I was thinking about that the other day. And yes, I think there is. I think there is. The remarkable thing is that, of course, at the beginning of the novel, Rochester isn't really a very nice person. He's a bit of a cad, really.
Mm.
And he treats her very badly. But at the same time, is very attracted by her. She, on the other hand, though she is a kind of very early feminist, that's to say, she wants to find work where women are accepted. And so both of them had their big differences from each other, but they nevertheless fall in love despite their differences. Yeah. And the question mark at the end is, I think, it's not very much emphasized, but it's just suggested that this is not the end of the story, that she's taking on something really big, and her beloved Rochester is now a crippled man and a blind man, and she still is determined and still loves him, and they do get together despite this, and despite his moral objections at the thought of her taking him on as a sort of semi-invalid. There's a little bit of tension, yes, there.
Yeah. I sensed that in the scoring of the last chord of all.
Yes.
The layout of the
yes.
chord.
Yes, just an open
yeah.
fifth.
Mm. Yes. I think Jane Eyre was not composed to commission. You composed it as a labour of love, basically.
Yes.
Is
yes.
that right?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm. And when did the process begin?
I think it must have been sometime in the early 80s. I can't remember the exact year, but it must have been soon after, I think, when I'd taken early retirement from the university. I did have commissions to get on with, which I did, and I would spend any time in between working on Jane Eyre, so I wrote it over quite a long period, alternating with other works as the commissions came in.
Did that involve any sort of development of style from the 80s up to when you completed the opera?
I don't know. I think It's difficult to tell, really, because as the situation changes, the music must change as well, of course. And whether that involves a change of style, I wouldn't know about that, but perhaps it does. But anyway, my attempt was to describe a process which leads from one situation to a very different one at the end.
Have you given each character any particular kind of timbre, any particular kind of motif?
Yes, the principal characters have their own motifs, rather like in Wagner, and these motifs play a part in the musical content and the quite symphonic development of the music. But I don't think the opera is influenced by Wagner, oddly enough. I think if it's influenced by anybody, it's influenced by the two last operas of Verdi. Not so much in the style of the music, but in the way it's constructed. Very freely. Not rigid divisions between recitative and aria, but a more free style, which will sometimes put the voice in relief and sometimes puts the orchestra as the main protagonist.
Yeah. The orchestra is very important, isn't it, in this opera?
Yes.
Have you had to make any alterations to the scoring for this particular performance and the recording?
Not in the scoring, no. But I have made some big cuts in the opera so that it lasts, I would guess, about 40 minutes or 45 minutes less than it did. This was partly because when the performance was first suggested to me, I took another look at it because it had been some years since I'd completed it. And it struck me then that it was in places much too long and taking too much time over things that were not of primary importance. So I think this final version will come out as much more concentrated.
So it wasn't difficult for you to make these cuts then? It was almost a positive thing that you had to do?
Yes. Mm. It was an attempt to make the opera better.
Yeah.
And I honestly think that I have made it much more concentrated. Mm-hmm. And each scene now contains a big event. I think there was too much time in the original version taken up with people getting to know other people and sort of minor situations. Mm-hmm. You can take your time writing a novel, but you can't take your time writing an opera.
No. These 45 minutes of discarded music, have you got any plans to use them in spin-offs from the opera?
Yes, there were five interludes, purely orchestral interludes in the opera, which I think made it too long. The gaps between the scenes, and I thought it could well do without these interludes, and I've not wasted them actually because they now form the basis of the new work, my Third Symphony.
Really?
Is this in addition to other music, but the actual sort of basis of the new work is symphonic.
Mm. Is this Third Symphony, is it going to be subtitled the Jane Eyre Symphony?
I called it Third Symphony on themes from the opera Jane Eyre. Mm-hmm. And I title each of the movements corresponding to the action in the opera, where the action takes place. Lowood School, Thornfield, the house of the Rivers family, who give her refuge when she abandons the wedding, the marriage, and then finally at Thornfield again.
And is the orchestra for the symphony the same as the orchestra for the opera?
No, it's a full symphonic orchestra, triple wind and the works. So that was a pleasure too, because I did feel occasionally rather constricted by the small orchestra I'd selected for the original.
There's also some music from the opera in a piano piece.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, there was a time when I thought I would never get the opera, I would never live to see the opera or to hear it. And so I actually used music from it in this piano piece. Mm. And I think I used bits of it in other pieces too, though I can't remember offhand just how and when this happened.
I suppose the opera has been part of you for so long that it almost comes out subconsciously in other works.
Yes. I think the whole process is subconscious. I think the subconscious plays an enormous part in creativity of any kind. So it's very difficult in a way to speak about one's own work, because I don't really know why I do it or how I do it. All I know is that I can only write what I can write. I can't at will change my style to anybody else's.
No. This particular project has aroused a great deal of interest in the opera itself, but also in you as a composer as you approach your 90th birthday.
Yes.
This must be extremely gratifying for you.
Yes, it is. It is. And it's all really arisen because of Siva Oak of SOMM Recordings, who's been a great friend to me for some considerable time.
Yeah, yes. We look forward to the performance, John. Thank you so much for this conversation. Thank you.
Right. Thank you.